Tonight, we see a dying natural resource.
And a thriving national resource.
See the artwork of Ted DiGrazia.
Hear from Father Joe Martin.
And from our own Mike Gallagher.
Hello, I'm Sean Huskamp.
And I am Monsignor Charles Minor. Welcome to this edition of Reel to Reel. Every era seems to come to a new knowledge of some old truth. And I think the one that typifies our era would be the knowledge of truth about environment.
And ecology should be a concern for everyone. As spring approaches and we begin to appreciate the beauty of the earth once again, we should take time to consider how carelessly we treat that beauty sometimes.
In the Bible, God tells man to subdue the earth and have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the fowl of the air, and over every living thing that moveth upon the earth. But at what point does subduing the earth become destroying the earth? In the heart of the Mid-Atlantic region, nestled between Maryland and Virginia, lies the Chesapeake Bay, the largest estuary in North America, and one of the most biologically productive in the world. It is a place of surpassing beauty, and by all appearances, remarkably unspoiled. The Spanish explorers who first landed here reverently called it the Bay of the Mother of God. Our nation was cradled here, beginning with the first permanent English settlement at Jamestown in 1607. And it was in St. Mary's City where the first laws were passed, allowing Catholics the right to worship as they pleased. The explorer, Captain John Smith, wrote that heaven and earth never agreed better on a place for man's habitation. It is many things to many people. To the commercial fisherman, it is his livelihood. To the recreational boater, it's a place to sail and swim and go fishing. To the biologist, it's an exciting place to study. And to our grandchildren, it may be lost forever.
It's been viewed as a dumping ground, and it's a place where we can put our waste where it won't bother us anymore.
Man-made pressures have placed the bay under severe stress and jeopardized its future.
This is a sewage treatment plant. They discharge 70 million gallons per day of treated sewage.
These high school students are learning about the bay from Don Jackson, an instructor for the Chesapeake Bay Foundation. The foundation has studied this body of water very closely, and they are convinced that only by educating others can there be any hope of saving the bay. Research cruises like this give the students first-hand experience of what the conditions in the bay really are.
There's so much food to be had here. This is such a rich place. This place is so stocked with things to eat that it makes an excellent nursery ground for young fish, for young organisms to grow up. There's actually two types of eels in the bay. There are narrow-headed eels and broad-headed eels. The broad-headed eels are more scavengers that live on the surface, on the top of the bottom itself. The narrow-headed eels will generally stay burrowed down in the bottom a little bit where they forage for little invertebrates.
There's a lot of petroleum in the harbor bottoms. Most of the time you think the oil is going to float off and form a slick. Well, if it's crude oil, only a part of it will do that. There's heavier fractions of the oil which separate and go to the bottom. And a lot of organisms get killed during oil spills, but this kind of stuff's down there all the time. And as you can see, not many worms or little annelids crawling around in that either.
There are many reasons behind the deterioration of the bay. Simply put, we are overloading the bay with nutrients, poisoning the water with toxins, and destroying the wetlands and grasses, without which the bay cannot survive. American industry uses between 45 and 50,000 chemicals, with 1,000 new ones being introduced each year. These chemicals have taken a heavy toll on the bay. Chesapeake is an old Indian word that means Great Shellfish Bay, and it was once.
At the turn of the century, the harvest of oysters was about 10 to 15 million bushels. I believe the figures for this past year were about 2 million bushels caught.
The decline is having a devastating effect on the oystermen and crabbers who live on the islands in the lower bay. Remote and vulnerable, Smith Island clings to a vanishing way of life. The 750 residents of Smith Island are direct descendants of the original settlers from Elizabethan England. For more than 300 years, the bay has provided a living for these proud and independent watermen. But this way of life may be lost to their descendants.
Grandfather and the old captain John the Boat used to say, them that know nothing fear nothing.
Alex Kellum of Smith Island believes that ignorance is at the root of the problem. Has man gone beyond subduing this body of water to the point of destroying it for all time? Alex Kellum still has hope.
I read a story once where it said the people on the Chesapeake Bay are doing their best to kill it, but it keeps fighting back. It keeps coming back.
I think there's hope for the bay. I think that it's got to be people, individuals, that come to the bay's rescue. But it really comes down to every individual taking a stance, believing that the bay is a place worth saving. And making an effort, a concerted effort, to do their part. I think it goes further than that. I think we're not only talking about the Chesapeake Bay, we're concerned about the bay here because it's our backyard. But I think in broader terms, we're talking about our planet, our entire planet.
Our last story proves that along with the benefits of technology and living in a modern world comes the responsibility for taking care of other things.
Stay with us. Coming up, we have Mike Gallagher, Father Joe Martin, and Ted DiGrazia.
A few weeks ago, we introduced you to Father Joe Martin, who operates an alcoholism treatment center in Maryland. He's back tonight in our DABAR segment with some advice on pain in our lives. In Arts Review, Mike Gallagher takes a look at a popular TV series, After MASH. But first, we'll take a look at the work of Ted DiGrazia, whose art depicts the lives and rituals of Arizona's people, particularly the Indians. Our Expressions is a collection of his paintings and some of his observations about his work.
I do have an audience, and I am grateful to people because they, the people, not critics, not anybody, has put me where I am. It's just plain old people who recognize the work and it speaks to them and wanna own it. They question nothing about it. It's an instinctive thing. People sometimes say, you know, I don't know anything about art, but I like your work. Go by instinct, and you're right. 9 out of 10, you will be right. I'm glad people like my work. I don't think that people worship idols. Man should be in the image of Christ or God, whichever they want, and it should be present at all times. And when you destroy that, you're destroying the rituals, you're destroying the rich tradition, the mysteries, and then it will go to pot. I see now lately that Christ is coming back in a strong way as a superstar, or whatever the young want to call it, but at least there is a Christ, and I think this is good.
Mike Gallagher. Today I want to talk about the hit TV show After MASH. As I'm sure there's no need to tell most of you, this sequel takes up the adventures of some of the MASH stalwarts after the onset of peace. Colonel Potter, played by Harry Morgan, has become chief surgeon at a veterans hospital in Missouri. There he's soon joined by the irrepressible Klinger, played by Jamie Farr, and Father Mulcahy, played by William Christopher. Now I suppose I should be kindly disposed towards After MASH, since I too am a veteran of the Korean War. An unhappy episode in our history, all but forgotten, though it's memorable enough if you happen to have been there. The fact is, however, that I am not kindly disposed towards After MASH, and I think it's best I tell you that right off, because you'd probably guess it in a minute anyway. Why is After MASH so popular? I think it's so popular, first of all, because it requires absolutely no effort to watch. Its fragmented style is ideally suited to short attention spans. Something else that makes for ease of viewing is that there's no trace of subtlety to besmirch its clarity. There's no real interplay between the actors, allowing for the kind of nuances that make Bob Newhart, for example, so funny. On After MASH, everybody declaims his or her lines at full pitch, like stand-up comedians, rather than like anything resembling real people. After MASH also makes us feel good. It does so by winking broadly at us and inviting us to join in the put-downs directed at officious types like Chief Administrator D'Angelo and his assistant, the cobra-like Alma. This makes us feel pleasantly liberal, a non-threatening liberalism that appeals to the naughty boy and even the crustiest conservative. It also makes us feel good by its clever way of raising serious issues so as to preclude the risk of stirring the least anxiety, a no-sweat humanism to go with its lots-of-laughs liberalism. Father Mulcahy, by the way, priest as wimp, fits in beautifully here. So don't hold your breath waiting for him to take a tough stand on abortion. Finally, there's a great book on the Vietnam War called Winners and Losers, and at one point, its author, Gloria Emerson, touches upon MASH. Often, she says, when she tried to talk to Americans at home about the tragic absurdity of the Vietnam War, they'd cut her off and say, yes, they knew all about tragic absurdity. They'd seen it on MASH. The problem with shows like MASH and After MASH, and no doubt with the network news as well, is that the sounds and images they convey contain just enough of reality to vaccinate us against it, to anesthetize our intellects, our imaginations, our capacity for enthusiasm and for indignation. I'm Mike Gallagher. That's this week's Arts Review.
Somebody once made the observation that into each life some rain must fall. Well, rain does fall in a lot of lives. I've often said that to live is to hurt. Everyone from birth to death experiences pain. And as you know, pain is of many kinds. There's physical pain that everybody is familiar with. A headache, a toothache, a fall down a flight of stairs, a boil, or perhaps more serious, some sort of disease like cancer, horrible pain. But there's pain, I think, that's even worse, and that's the mental and emotional anguish that most of us go through to a greater or lesser degree through our lives. There's disappointment, there's failure, there's humiliation, insults, sadness, grief, but above all else, having your motives misjudged, being misrepresented, and so forth. I believe that we had best use pain or it'll use us. And we are all familiar with people who have let pain, consciously or unconsciously, use them. They usually wind up being the whiners and the gripers and the shriveled people that nobody likes to be around. And yet if you think of the people you love most, the happiest people that you know, their lives are loaded with suffering, but they have learned, as Christ taught us, to use pain rather than let it use them. It's awfully difficult to pray with a toothache, but I think if we begin each day by offering its pain, whatever that pain might be, up to God for our own good and the good of others, we can become really great. I know some POWs who have become saints by using pain instead of letting it use them.
Last week, we showed you how students are working to rebuild houses in Philadelphia. Our next story goes a step further, in a way, to Minneapolis, St. Paul, to see how the Archdiocese there is rebuilding whole communities.
Nobody much noticed, but on August 15, 1983, Anthony Pastiglione went to jail. According to court testimony, the tenants in a 54-room building on West 85th Street, many of them elderly and disabled, were assaulted by men wearing ski masks. These men used crowbars, knives, and guns to attack the tenants in their own homes. People were locked out of their own apartments. Their rooms were burglarized and vandalized. Their heating and hot water were cut off in the middle of the winter. The alleged ringleader behind these attacks, Anthony Pastiglione, was the landlord of the building. He was trying to force the low-income residents out so that expensive, more profitable condominiums could be built on the property. This kind of action is becoming increasingly common in large cities all over the United States. The result is an explosion of homeless people. In 1982, in New York City alone, 60,000 homeless citizens passed through city agencies. The housing shortage has created a major crisis for the city, which spends $70 million a year to place the homeless in emergency shelters and hotels. After years of retreating from the invasion of the young urban pioneers, known as yuppies, the minority and low-income residents of the Selbydale neighborhood in St. Paul, Minnesota, have come upon a solution which allows them to remain in their own neighborhoods. The Selbydale Cooperative offers low-income households a rare opportunity, a chance to build equity for the future through cooperative ownership of their own homes. The project was developed by the Community Development Corporation, an arm of the Catholic Archdiocese of St. Paul and Minneapolis. Joe Arago heads the corporation.
Selbydale area is historically the black community in St. Paul. We got involved there about 3 years ago. What happened is private individuals, younger families, two-income families, generally with a lot of money, younger professionals, tended to buy up the older houses and renovate them for their purposes. It's good for the tax base, it's good for the city in the broad sense, but it tended to displace people who lived in those neighborhoods. Generally, those people displaced were lower income, were minorities. So the Selbydale project was, in a sense, a response to that.
Selbydale was designed to serve as low and moderate income families. And it offers people a chance at home ownership, which they normally could not afford. All of our people that have bought in here are first-time home buyers. They've never owned a home before.
The corporation went up against 11 other developers in competition for the right to build. In the early stages, community leaders were very skeptical of the promise to employ 10 to 15% minorities in the construction of the project. This goal was surpassed, and eventually more than 50% minority members were hired.
One of the reasons the church is in this is the bishops back in 1975 issued a pretty strong statement on housing called the right to a decent home. And that's some strong words. Everybody has a right to a decent home. That's like the right to health care, and that's a right, it's not a privilege.
Joe, you got a minute we can talk about the Miles groundbreaking?
Sure, let's do that.
We can't leave it to the whims of the free market because the free market isn't going to provide except what's going to give it a return on its investment. And the free marketplace doesn't necessarily look at the social return and the social goals. It looks at dollars only.
It should work good, I think.
Yeah, well, that sounds good.
The cost of housing is a problem these days, even for the middle class. Many simply cannot afford it, even if they are making a relatively good wage. The problem is all the more severe for those on low and fixed incomes, such as the elderly and the handicapped. Red Rock Manor, an attractive apartment complex, is another example of how the Archdiocese has met this challenge. Here it was a simple case of compassion versus profit.
22.
The land on which this apartment complex was built used to be owned by Elizabeth, who is now a resident. A private contractor had offered to buy her 2 acres of land so that he could put up 6 homes on it. He offered her a very good sum of money, but she had other ideas.
I just thought it over and I started thinking about the older people living around here, the widows and widowers. So I turned them down. I said, no, I'm going to hold this for senior housing.
Elizabeth held on to her land and lost an opportunity to make a lot of money, but she does not regret her decision. Not long after, the Archdiocese approached her and offered to buy her land and build housing for senior citizens.
I tell you, it really made me happy because it was just like a dream coming true. And now to see these people, how they enjoy it, it just makes me happy.
Most of the people here have had a change in their lifestyle, that is, the death of a spouse. That was so in my case. And so it makes a big difference. And when you're here, there's so many people that are in that position, and I think that might be one of the things that helped them to look out for each other.
Hospitality, the convenience, the equipment here, and everything is superb, and the management is superb. You couldn't ask for anybody any better than our managers that we have right here at NOW.
The managers here do not assault their own tenants with knives, guns, and crowbars, nor do they turn off the heat in the bitter cold Minnesota winter. If anything, the managers overflow with warmth and concern for their people.
about them, but they know that we care about them. For example, we were sitting out there one day, and I put up a sign on a bulletin board, and it said, "Have you kissed your kid today?" And one of the ladies, "Well, I don't have nobody." So I finished putting that thumbtacks in that little thing on a bulletin board, and I went over and I gave her a great big hug and a kiss, and I said, "Don't ever let me hear you say that again. You've got us."
Places do exist where landlords will go to any length necessary to make as much money as possible, even if that means forcing the low-income tenants out of their own homes. But there are also places like this, which show that wherever people have a voice in their own destiny, everyone profits.
None of us ever wants to stand in the road of healthy progress, but we must take care about the wrench it causes to people's lives, as it did to those old people we just saw in Minneapolis-St. Paul. It really was a form of violence.
And another form of violence that we witnessed tonight was the violence done to our environment when we carelessly polluted.
Next time on Crosstalk, we discuss Catholic education for non-Catholic students.
Visit a home for troubled teens that was founded by a priest.
And a camp open to families only.
Father Walt Nolan and Dr. Bill Larkin join us.
And we'll see the work of the sidewalk artist.
As always, it's good to be with you. Good night, and God bless you.
Thanks for being with us. Good night.